Hi friends, here in this video we are going to see the derivation of the flexural formula. So let's get started. The derivation of the flexural formula, also called as the flexural equation. First, I'll draw the diagram of the beam. Here I am taking an example of a simply supported beam supported at point A and B, and the length of the beam is L. Here there is a load which is acting over the beam W. Since we are considering pure bending, under the action of this load the beam would bend in a curvature. So from this, here I would be taking a small section of the beam and show it before bending and after bending. Drawing the diagram for the same. So here is the diagram before bending. I have taken a small section of the beam having length dx. EF is the length of the portion which is equal to dx onto the neutral axis or the neutral layer. Now from the neutral layer I am considering another layer gh at a small distance y. So this is the condition before bending. Now I'll draw the diagram for after bending and then we'll analyze the further part. The beam would be bending in an arc as shown in figure. Considering the simply supported beam, here it is bending in a sagging pattern. So I have shown a sagging pattern here. Now the radius of curvature of the beam. This point O indicates the center, and here up to the neutral axis the radius of curvature is capital R. And the dx portion, I'll show it over here. And this dx portion, now the length has been changed. I'll say that I'll call it as the planes. Here it is plane AB, this vertical plane, and this is plane CD, another vertical plane. So that would become A dash after bending. This would be B dash. Similarly, here C dash and D dash. Next, the layer at the neutral axis, which is EF, will now become E dash, F dash, and at a small distance y the layer GH will become G dash, H dash. It would also be bending in an arc, so that is G dash, H dash, and it is at a small distance y, as I have explained. And this angle is theta of the curvature of the beam. So this is the condition after bending. So here these are the conditions of the beam before bending and after bending, and there are some assumptions in the flexural formula, like for example the material of the beam is homogeneous and isotropic, that is having same material composition throughout. And isotropic means it would be having the same modulus of elasticity in all directions. Next, the neutral axis or the neutral layer, it would be having the same length before bending and after bending. That is, the neutral axis does not have, the bending does not have any effect on the neutral axis. And then the transverse sections which remain plane even before bending and after bending. So these are the some assumptions. Now how I'll start the derivation is, first I'll say that this layer EF is equal to layer GH, since layer EF is equal to layer GH. Then from the after bending, I'll find the distance of this layer, that is E dash F dash. So therefore the length of the layer G dash H dash will be equal to, now just to explain a small point here, I have indicated the radius here, but angle of theta would end only up to the curvature. I am just making a small correction here, that this is the angle which is subtended by the beam. So we have to remember the angle is not with respect to this line, which is the radius, but it ends over this blue line, that is theta is only up till here. So now, since this angle which I am getting, this complete angle is in actual, that is theta, that is the radius, here I am getting the angle. And now when I need to get the length of this arc E dash F dash and G dash H dash, first I am starting with G dash H dash, it is this arc. So the radius of this arc is, it is from O up to here, neutral axis, it is capital R, and then it is Y. So the distance is R plus Y and the angle is theta, angle subtended over here. So therefore layer G dash H dash is having the length of arc, which is R plus Y distance into theta. So finally it would be R theta plus Y theta. So that is G dash H dash, and it is after bending. Next, before bending we can say, or I'll say that E dash F dash, since the radius is R and the angle subtended is theta, so the length of this E dash F dash would be R into theta. And now since this layer E dash F dash is the neutral layer which would be having the same length before and after bending, so E dash F dash is equal to EF, and here we have seen that EF is also equal to GH, so this would also be equal to GH. Then I'll find the change in length. So therefore after this, the change in length denoted by delta L or deflection would be the length of layer G dash H dash, that is after bending minus before bending. So as I have considered the layer GH, so after bending it is having the length GH H dash, G dash H dash, and then here it is before bending it is GH. So the difference gives us the change in length. G dash H dash we have got it as R theta minus, it is plus Y theta, then minus GH value, GH which is equal to EF into this diagram, EF is the neutral layer which is having the same length even before bending and after bending. So layer E dash F dash is same as layer EF, and that is equal to GH having value R theta. So putting the value of GH as R theta, so plus R theta minus R theta gets cancelled out, and finally the deflection which I am getting here, it is Y theta. Now after getting the change in length, I'll find the strain in the layer, since strain in the layer is given by change in length upon original length, that is by the definition of strain. Change in length we have got it as Y theta. Original length is of the layer GH, or we can say it is R theta, so that would be R theta. Now theta gets cancelled, and what remains here is E is equal to Y upon R. Now since this strain, the modulus of elasticity capital E is given as stress upon strain, So therefore, strain becomes stress upon Young's modulus. This we can get it from Hooke's law. And now strain, instead of that, I'll put sigma upon E. And since we are considering bending here, this stress would be bending stress. So finally, instead of strain, it is sigma B upon capital E is equal to Y upon R. And therefore, sigma B upon Y, I am shifting the terms, is equal to capital E by R. And this is the first part of the flexural formula, which we have got, and I'll keep it as equation A. Then after reaching up till here, we have the second part of the derivation. In that, I am considering the cross section of the beam. This is the cross section, and here is the neutral axis or the neutral layer. Now from the neutral layer, I am considering a small area of the cross section. Now this area is dA, located at a distance of small y from the neutral axis. Now I'll find the force which is acting over this small amount of area. So I'll say that from equation A, the bending stress would be E into Y upon R. And now I want to find the force which is acting over this small area. So therefore, small amount of force acting on area dA would be dF, and that would be equal to stress into area, that is bending stress into area is dA, and that is because since stress is equal to force upon area, we are finding for the small area, so that becomes small amount of force dF, which is bending stress into small area dA. Now I'll put the value of bending stress over here, so it becomes E into Y divided by R dA. Now this force is acting over the small area dA, and the force is dF. Now I would be taking the moment of this force about the neutral axis. So moment would be dF into distance y, that would be the small amount of moment dm. Small amount of moment acting on area dA would be small amount of force dF into distance y. So therefore dm value will become E into y into dA upon R into y. So finally that would be dm is equal to E into y square dA divided by R. So that is the small amount of moment acting. Now if I want to find the total moment for the entire cross section, because this moment is there only for the small area dA, for that I need to integrate this equation. So therefore, integrating on both sides, so integration of dm is equal to E upon R integration of y square dA. So integration of small moment will give me the capital moment or the total moment for the cross section of the beam. E upon R are constants for the beam. So it would be integration of y square dA. And by definition, this is called as the second moment of area, also called as the moment of inertia, which is denoted by I. So since by definition, I, that is the moment of inertia, is the second moment of area, which is integration y square dA, called as the second moment of area. So therefore, now here also reshuffling the terms, I would be into the denominator of M. So M upon I is equal to E by R, and this I would be keeping it as equation B from equation A we got sigma B upon Y is equal to E by R. Equation B M upon I is equal to E by R. So combining equations A and B we get M upon I is equal to sigma B by Y is equal to capital E by R. So this is called as the flexural formula or flexural equation, and it would be required for solving the problems of bending stresses, or we can say stresses in beams. Here the terms are M is called as the maximum bending moment, I is the moment of inertia for the entire section of the beam, sigma B is the bending stress, which if we put Y as maximum, that is the distance from the neutral axis to the topmost layer, so it would be maximum bending stress, capital E is the Young's modulus for the beam material, and R is the radius of curvature. So in short, we have seen in this video the derivation regarding the flexural formula. And at the end, if you'll find my videos helpful, you can like, share, comment and subscribe our channel and share it amongst your family and friends. Thanks for watching.